One of the factors in cloud native apps states you should store your configuration and settings outside of your application code. In this episode, Andrew gives us a rundown on how configuration options in .NET Core allows for layers of configurability and abstractions for your app. Let's go have a conversation with Andrew. Andrew.
Hey, Shayne.
How are you, man?
Pretty good.
All right. So, configuration in ASP.NET Core.
Yeah.
It's come a long way.
Certainly.
Right? So, when I used to do configuration in my ASP.NET apps, it was an XML file or many XML files, right?
Really, just the one big XML file.
And if I messed up that XML file, it like wrecked my day.
Yeah.
Right? So, I know that you've been working with the team and we've been making this better for cloud native apps.
Yep.
So, I want to have a conversation and see what we've done, what options we have, and see kind of where we've come from that big XML file, and talk about security, layering, and all of the work that you've done with the team.
Yeah.
And let's just go have a discussion.
Sounds good. Yeah, let's go.
All right, Andrew. So by default, .NET Core manages our settings and our configuration kind of in a order of operations. You know, we've got a lot of options as to where we can store our configurations and our settings. Can you talk about, you know, how that works and kind of what overrules what when it comes to the decisions the framework makes as to what wins?
Right, yeah, I mean, it's a layering system basically, because you have different sources of configuration in your app usually. Sometimes you've got like a JSON file, or you might have environment variables, you might have some configuration that's actually just code in your app.
Okay.
And so we allow you to kind of layer those things and configure the layering the way you want. So, but by default, we have some pretty, you know, sensible defaults. So you've got a JSON file in your app by default that has the settings. On top of that, you could, if you have any settings in your code, those can override that.
Okay.
And if you have environment variables, which are very common, like for this instance of the app, I really want to set this config this way. That kind of overrides all of it. But even that default layering is completely configurable.
Okay.
It's configurable configuration, you might say.
Okay, great.
Where you can just kind of wire it up in the order you want, and the particular settings can be overridden at different layers.
Okay. So given that, can I mix those options? Can I have a JSON file and an environment variable and an any file, XML? If I really want to get crazy and I say, I want all these different ones, and I can just put those in there, and the framework just knows that I can do that. The middleware, the configuration middleware, is what we're talking about here.
It puts
those in there, right? So, what about environments? What about I've got QA and I've got staging and I've got that. So, in the past, if I go back to previous versions of ASP.NET, I would have to do XML transforms, right, to do that, and dealing with those big XML files in the build. I believe we were using MS Build to do that, and there was a craft to making that happen, and have to set that up for my QA, my dev, and that. What's the practice of doing that now to separate my environments and making that work?
Yeah, I mean, in the past, you used to kind of transform the file, as the config as you built, right? And you'd end up with a different output for development, for staging, for QA, et cetera. What we've tried to do now is really separate it out so that that configuration can be adjusted at runtime depending on where you're running.
Okay.
So the environment that you talk about, like there's just one of the settings that we sort of bless and know as this is the environment name, right? Development by default, you know, you can set it to production, you can set it to staging, and the name's up to you.
Okay.
And then you can make decisions based on that, including decisions about configuration.
Mm-hmm.
So you can say, hey, by default, we talked about the layering, by default, we're going to load this one JSON file that defines the config for my app. But if we're in development, we're going to load another JSON file after that and override any of the settings in there.
Okay.
If we're in production, we'll load a different JSON file and override settings. So you can have different settings based on the different environments, and you can change those and change environments without redeploying your app at any time.
So is that a naming convention that we have? So
yeah, the name's default, the name is development, staging, production. That's just our defaults that we've chosen.
Okay.
You can choose whatever you want.
So this allows me to take my files. You know, in a previous episode, we talked with Abel about DevOps.
Right.
So now I can take those files and store them separately in my configuration, you know, GitHub repo outside of my code, and be able to manage that in my DevOps process and deploy that with my code to the necessary environments.
Right.
And then it just knows how to happen.
Yeah, and you can build your code artifacts once and then deploy them to your different environments with different configuration as
okay.
you do it.
Okay, awesome. Well, now that we've got kind of a base of what's in the box and we've got an idea of how the middleware works and doing that, what about taking some of the stuff and externalizing it, not just in files, but maybe pushing this into my cloud environments? Because when it comes to cloud native, I want to make sure that I'm not tied directly to my code. We are now talking about files, but what if I want to put this configuration actually in my cloud platform and talk further into maybe some of the security and things of that nature? Kind of what's the story there? And again, mixing some of those configurations, what do we have available to us either in a .NET ecosystem or maybe an Azure ecosystem?
Yeah, we talked about files and environment variables. These are all just providers that we provide out of the box.
Okay.
It's a completely pluggable system. You can plug in whatever system you want to store your configuration, but we also provide a lot of really powerful options for you. We got the files, we got the environment variables. That's really good. The environment variables tend to be really useful for those. I have some things in production in my Azure app service. Maybe you set those app settings, they come out as environment variables and they just appear in your app. But when we talk about going to large cloud native applications, we talk about wanting to centralize configuration, starting to be able to manage it across all your different services. That's where we get into some of the Azure services, like Azure App Configuration, which allows you to do exactly that. Mm-hmm. They have a system that plugs right into the .NET Core configuration model. It loads the config off of a central configuration store, and you can just access it just like any other. And the best part is your code doesn't have to know the difference, right? So when you're running in development, they could all be in a JSON file, and you could be testing against that JSON file. Mm-hmm. And then when you deploy to production, in the production environment, it's pointed to this Azure App Configuration service, and they're just loading, and the code hasn't changed to do that.
Mm. And we still handle that as far as the layering is concerned,
right.
too, right? Okay.
Yeah, awesome. So like your development settings might be in that JSON file, and then they get overridden by the settings in Azure App Configuration.
Now, if we're using something as far as securing these settings to provide, do we have a built-in provider for something like Azure Key Vault to secure them, and then I can then use that across other apps even? Do we have a provider for that as well?
Yeah, so we have Azure Key Vault provider as well. And I think Azure App Configuration and Azure Key Vault make a really good pair in this model, because App Configuration can be for your sort of general configuration settings, the things that aren't necessarily secrets that need to be hard securely managed. Mm-hmm. And then Azure Key Vault, which is the hardware protected secure data store in Azure, can plug in as well, and again, we get the layering, right? So you can have your JSON file, your app configuration, and your Key Vault secrets can layer into that and mix in with that. So you can store your database password or your credentials for some service in Key Vault, but you can store all the rest of the settings about your database, all the rest of the configuration that you need to access that service can be stored in the app configuration store, and then the Key Vault stuff just merges in with that, like just freely.
It's good you mentioned connection strings, because it brings up a point about just conventions. I know that, and this may or may not be true, but when I'm building up these different files and different environment variables, I say like knowing my environment, like I know it's a development environment. Are there naming conventions that we should be aware of when we're abstracting this from our code? Like ASP.NET Core _ environment, right, is one pattern. Are there other patterns to be aware of when we're pulling this out of our code that we need to worry about or be cognizant of when we're putting in these configurations and abstracting it? Are there other patterns that we should be aware of?
Most of the biggest pattern, I think, is some consistency is really valuable. One of the things we sort of learned early on is when we started with .NET Core, we had this really powerful, flexible configuration system, and we provided no defaults, right? We didn't provide you with a default JSON file. We said, you can do whatever you want, and that was great. And then people said, but what should we do, right?
Sure.
In later versions of .NET Core, we've brought in some default settings, some default names for settings. So like, there's tons of things in .NET Core you can configure. You can configure the server, you can configure the authentication systems, the logging, that kind of stuff. It was all very decoupled originally, and you didn't know how to plug them together.
Okay.
But now there's very consistent naming. It's, you know, the names of these settings is well defined, it's understood. And so when you're building, say, a component for use in a cloud native app that may be used in multiple different kinds of apps, having some consistency there is really valuable. Being able to just define, hey, however you're doing config, these are the names of the settings. You mentioned the ASP.NET Core underscore environment. That's a well-defined name, and we document that and make that very clear.
And connection strings, I believe, is connection strings underscore, right? So, and we can check our docs, and we've got that well-documented in ASP.NET for that. So let's jump back into security real quick.
Yeah.
You mentioned, and we talked a little bit about the Azure Key Vault implementations or capabilities that we have. Is it just built in? Do we have a provider? How do I get that into my app? And can you talk a little bit about, you know, how do we take control of those capabilities and insert that into our app?
So, I mean, we have a built-in provider that you can just enable. You do run into this kind of catch-22 when you're dealing with something like Key Vault, because you've got all your settings are stored in Key Vault. Well, that's great, but how do you connect to Key Vault, right? And that is a setting itself, right?
Okay.
One of the things that makes that real, that Azure does to make that really easy is this Azure Managed Service Identity, right? So this is the idea that you can actually you can install it on your virtual machine, your Kubernetes service, wherever. It's supported on all these various Azure compute services. Wherever your service is running, you can enable this Managed Service Identity, and you can give that resource, that container, that pod in Kubernetes or the VM, access to Key Vault directly.
Okay.
And you can authenticate that. You can say you can only access these certain settings, you can access this value, you know, you can do these things. And when you do that, you're freed up somewhat from having that, well, where do I put the password for the Key Vault?
Sure.
Right? Like, where do I configure the password for the Key Vault if the passwords are in the Key Vault?
Okay.
With Managed Service Identity, you've got that kind of built-in identity that allows you to just have that trusted link between your runtime components, your containers, and the Key Vault.
So, do I have to use the managed service identity, or can I just take that password and then also put it into something like my environment variables on my service, or embedded into my container that I'm running? So, you're right. We do get into this kind of, where do I hide the egg a little bit with our manage with our IDs and passwords. I would probably defer to my DevOps person, right? Maybe I'll call Abel again and say, hey, I've got all these passwords, how do I manage that? And have that as a follow-up. But that does get into the practices and relationships between some of our services, our DevOps practices, these passwords and configurations, and how do we manage those things. Are there some other things that we're doing in the framework when it comes to configurations and settings related to cloud native that we need to be aware of? Are we doing something special in containers, in some of the other managed middle frameworks that you can think of that we should be aware of?
Well, and containers are another, you know, they're a big space that we're looking at when we build these cloud native apps and these cloud native frameworks. We have, for example, built-in configuration support for Docker secrets and for Kubernetes secrets. So we have the, again, like you talk about everything being in the box. Like, we try to put as much as we can in the box so that you have all the tools you need, but you also have the flexibility you want to do what you want. And containers are right there. There's something we support with a lot of our defaults.
Right. So and the good thing is, I know just from using the product, that just because it's built into the box, we're not constrained to that.
Right.
Right. We can take that and you put it into other places, like the actual files in the environment variables, put them in the Key Vault. So we have some flexibility, again, looking to the docs to give that prescriptive guidance on how we're doing things there. Right?
Yeah, and I think one of the big things we've done with .NET Core is everything is visible, right? We don't hide things away in these like complex systems and complex configuration models where everything's in one giant file, you don't know where to find it, how to move it, how to figure that out. And but we have some defaults that make some really nice prescriptive guidance to say this is a way we think works really well, but it's transparent. You can do what you want. You can adjust it how you want.
Great. Do you have any closing tips, things you can point out, point people to when it comes to using configuration, when it comes to building these native apps, or maybe lessons learned that you can point the community to and kind of give them some guidance on?
A lot of it's contained in our docs. I think we have a really good amount of docs about just describing all the ways that you can configure things and the ways you can set it up. They have a lot of good docs on the patterns you use to actually consume the configuration in your code, because that's a whole nother section here. Is the configuration is really just the strings, right? The key value pairs.
Right.
But how do you actually bind that to some rich data objects that you can use to actually pass into various components and use to build your app? We have a lot of good docs on that as well.
Okay.
And I think that's sort of the thing we've learned most about configuration is that flexibility is really good, but it's also useful to be prescriptive in places and to say, yes, you can do whatever you want, but here's the pattern that we think works well.
Okay.
And that's something that I think also holds true to people building, you know, cloud native components or individual services, is that in order for these things to work well together, having some conventions, having some default patterns helps out a lot there.
Awesome. Andrew, thank you for coming on the show. That was configuration with ASP.NET Core and cloud native apps. Be sure to check out the show notes and the docs related to this, and we will see you next time. Thanks for watching the Cloud Native Show. Be sure to subscribe, watch for a future episode, and especially our streaming shows on Twitch, where we build apps based on the conversations had right here. We'll see you next time.